Welcome back to Tech Adventures. Today we're going to be looking at a 4x4 color matrix in Nuke using only native nodes, so no GPU, no Blinkscript, and no plugins. Let's dive in. So here is a quick overview of the script we're going to look at today. First off, let's have a look at the C4x4 color matrix. This is what we're going to build today. This tool was primarily inspired by Sebastian and Pedro. Their links will be in the description of the video, and also they're available in the tool. The user interface resembles what you'd expect to see of a 4x4 matrix. Now we'll look at the demo first off. This demo is of a 2D transform, which is utilizing multiple versions of the C4x4 color matrix. Given there are some modifications to each of the versions utilized, but the base tool is the same. Much like other tools, it is reliant on data coming in, and in this case, we're using pixel space. Being it is in pixel space, there are some problems that we will encounter, such as bounding box issues. These limitations can be worked around, however, it can be an advantage to not utilize a bounding box in the traditional sense, as this will force us to calculate pixels outside of the screen space that we may or may not need. Additionally, the bounding box limitations can prevent us from creating infinite planes, which otherwise would not be achievable. We will look into this 2D transform in future and how to construct it, but right now I want to just focus in on the 4x4 color matrix that we are creating today, and also focus in on how fast and efficient it is. At the moment, both viewers are being driven by the same transform. This way, we can do a comparison of the two methods and their speed in comparison. As demonstrated, the speed between them is negligible. But why build this? Surely Nuke has its own color matrix. And the answer is yes, it does. But it's a 3x3. And unfortunately, turning on an additional channel doesn't give you additional control. Unfortunately, we don't get the same options available to us when we create a color matrix as we do when we create a filter matrix or a spatial matrix. As you can see here, I've created a 4x4 filter matrix. However, I cannot do the same with the color matrix. 4x4 color matrixes have been built by other people beforehand. In the case of C4x4 matrix by Ivan, it was done as a plugin, which requires the plugin to be recompiled for every major and minor version of Nuke that is released for it to be useful. This is unfortunate because C4x4 matrix had some amazing features. However, due to the requirement for it to be regularly updated and recompiled, eventuated in the tool not being updated to the more recent versions of Nuke, with the latest version of the tool only being available up to Nuke version 9. C4x4 kernel steps in here, removing the requirement for it to be a plugin by utilizing Blink to facilitate doing the matrix. However, I'm not personally the biggest fan of Blink, as this requires your farm to have functionality around GPU, and it also has limitations surrounding Blinkscript itself. Some other software packages do have a 4x4 color matrix natively built into them. However, those two are limited by the number of dimensions that we can have access to. It was my investigation into 4D noise that made me reconsider the use case scenarios for my method of constructing a 4x4 color matrix. This was inspired by Matt's TD work in 4D noise, volumetric fog, and voxels. I decided a subframe approach might be more useful. With subframes, you could iterate through a space as opposed to the traditional 3D approach. And it seemed like an organic extension of the iterative space that Chris Fryer and myself have both independently been examining and exploring. I started out by using C44 kernel to test my ideas, as it is a 4x4 color matrix. As the transforms are taking place in a color space sense, it stays incredibly performative. This doesn't change as we go from GPU to CPU. I was also playing with the idea of infinite planes and wrapping UVs. So again, I was using C44 kernel to be able to test these ideas out. I was doing this by allowing our colors to go into negative values or numbers over 1, and then use a modulo expression to be able to wrap them back between the values of 0 and 1. So we could use an ST map to remap our input texture. I was also playing with hidden nodes such as Transform 3D. There is a great article over at Gatimedia which shows you how you can find some of those older hidden nodes. I really like the simplicity of this tool. It doesn't require a scanline render or a card. It is all self-contained. However, as you may notice with anything that is kind of card related and scanline related, you can sometimes get amazingly big bounding box issues. This is regularly apparent in conversions from 3D to 2D. Interestingly enough, the tool actually does function in a 3D space. The tool can be driven by an axis externally. I was also looking into how the native transform in Nuke actually functions under the hood. The position tool is a more primitive version of the transform node and tends to function only in positional data. This suggests that a method of building a transform could be done by manipulating an ST map that is normalized between 0 and 1. Simply by adding to the red or the green channel. In this example, the values are jumping up and down based on screen space, not pixel space, which is why it is moving in percentages of the screen. As one can see, this functions very similarly to the position node, which is also a hidden node. To be able to build and use a 4x4 matrix, there are some requirements. The first being the ability to be able to plus. The other being that we're able to multiply. We also need to be able to have the capability of actually shuffling or manipulating channels. This can be with the new shuffle or with the old shuffle. Interestingly enough, the old shuffle in itself was actually a color matrix, with the crosses accounting for a 1 value and when it was uncrossed being a 0 value. You will also need to be able to have an ability to stipulate or extract the screen coordinates, be it in exact pixel space or in some other variation of it. As you can see here, as we zoom in, the red channel responds to our X coordinate, as can be seen in the value coming out of the red channel, and our green responds to the Y coordinate. This works and gives us a value for every single pixel on the screen. There are other methods of finding a position according to a screen space or pixel space. Essentially, one of these is required in any outcome for us to be able to use an ST map. Because we need to be able to generate a normalized version of an ST map. This makes it viable to build a 4x4 matrix or bigger than a 4x4 in these programs. There are limitations I have found in After Effects, because you require an add-on for the ST map, and Blender, you may be able to do so using the UV of a card parented to the camera. We're going to have a look at building a blend now. A blend allows you to have three image inputs in this case scenario, and using the weights of each of those inputs, you can control how much one is apparent versus the other. So in essence, it is multiplying each input by the weight. Then it is summing all of those together. It then normalizes it by dividing it by the sum of the weights. If we turn the normalization off, it will just be adding the multiplied inputs together. This means we can easily build this using a few multipliers as weights and a plus to sum our values. A multiply with an expression acts as our normalization by dividing our summed pixel values by the sum of the weight values. As you can see, all of our multiplied pixel values are summed together. This setup gives us the same result as a blend. The final multiply node is used for normalization. The expression used for this can be seen on the node. It works the same as the normalization on the blend node. When the multiply node doing the normalization is turned off, it acts the same as when the normalization is turned off on the blend node. Keeping this in mind, we'll be using blend nodes instead of an assortment of multiply and plus nodes, as it will keep our scripts cleaner and help us focus on the architecture of the color matrix. I have already set up a preliminary build so we don't spend too much time on the basics. But in essence, we are extracting the RGBA channels, then shuffling them to be fully independent of each other. At the other end, we are soloing each channel by blackening out the other channels that do not correlate to the original input channel. Then the sum of those outputs are copied back to the RGBA. In each shuffle, one channel is copied across all the other channels. This can be done with the new or the old shuffle node. I will use a color wheel to demonstrate the results in a visual manner. The order of the channels is significant. The RGBA is normally used to represent X, Y, Z, W, respectively. As we all want a 4x4 interface, I tend to cheat by using a 4x4 spatial or filter matrix, as I can stipulate the dimensions of the matrix interface to be created. When building this into a group or a gizmo, you can pick the matrix when managing the user knobs, allowing a 4x4 interface to drive the color matrix. Let's introduce our blends. When connecting them, much like the order of the channels is very specific, so is the order that the blends are connected. 1 should be connected to R, 2 to G, 3 to B, and 4 to the alpha channel outputs. This order doesn't change from blend to blend. Once all of our blends are connected correctly, we will need to link our blends to our matrix interface. This needs to be done row by row with close attention to the linking of the blends. Once this is complete, you will have a functioning 4x4 color matrix in Nuke using only native nodes, no GPU, no Blink, no plugin. This method can be used to create larger 5x5 or 6x6 matrices through the use of additional channels, blends, and a larger matrix for the interface. This setup could be used to create more complex matrices for machine learning purposes. As we have already seen the 2D transform example, I'll use the same setup in a slightly different manner. Being it is a color matrix, it will obviously work on color, and it is good to get an understanding of what availability this perspective can provide you with. The original use of this color matrix was for a 2D transform, so it is only affecting our red and green channels, but it shows us its potential. We can build a 3D transform with the color transform we've built, but for the sake of ease, I'll connect an axis's world matrix to our matrix. Our color matrix will behave very similar to a grade node. Note that we need an alpha channel for our color matrix to work. Our scale acts as a gain or multiply would in a grade node, and the translate and pivot act similar to an offset, black point, or lift in a grade node. However, the rotations and skews can give us some very interesting results, similar to a hue shift. Now I'm going to show you a less known setup. I'm going to use a CMS generator to create a cube with the hidden node 3D LUT Geo. We are going to explore color data as positional data. So this should give you the idea of RGBA and XYZW being interchangeable. Let's test that idea out more practically. I think this now has our minds in a good space to consider perspective projection matrices, which will allow us to transfer 3D data to 2D data and 2D data to 3D. The primitive elements for our own scanline renderer. Additionally, this should show this has potential for animations, simulations, and geometry in Nuke. Being able to easily store over 2 million points as pixels for one HD frame and over 8 million for one 4K frame. The output is an image, making it much easier to rescale for additional interpolated points and LODs. But I feel that this is going to be for another video. If you wish to learn more about this, I recommend Matt and Pedro's Nuke Expressions 101 post on Nukepedia. The link will be in the description. Please be sure to like and subscribe. Join my Discord. If you are feeling especially grateful and supportive, please sign up on my Patreon, where I have built a fully functional and ready to download C4x4 color matrix. And in a year from now, it will be publicly available for free. Until then, I'll see you next time on Tech Adventures.